The area known as Frostown, on the northeast edge of downtown, was likely settled before Houston.
They scattered at the head of tide of the small rivers that fed into Buffalo Bayou, is where they mostly set up. And they were individual farmers, but they were little settlements like Harrisburg, like Lynchburg, like White's Landing.
And there was some evidence of groups of people who had already been here from the 1820s, who had grouped and lived around the bayou, all the way from the San Jacinto River on up through Buffalo Bayou, White Oak Bayou.
There were about 90 people living along Buffalo Bayou, according to some of the census and documents that we've read in diaries. And so they were scattered up and down the bayou, but there were small settlements.
And remember, the primary reason to be here was the sawmill business. So there were people here operating numerous sawmills and lumbering operations long before there was the notion of Houston.
This is where Jonathan Frost came in 1836.
We think that Frost came down from Tennessee, made some sort of a verbal agreement to do business with the Allen brothers in the future, and then went off about setting up a blacksmith shop and some sort of residential housing.
He moved his family from Tennessee onto this 10-acre tract. Unfortunately, Jonathan died of cholera almost immediately thereafter.
And when he died, his heirs, his sons, basically transacted the property, and they were the ones that subdivided it, sold it off into 36 different individual lots to raise money to get out of the community, to take their grant process and take their land on the Brazos River, which was the more desired location to raise cattle and do agriculture.
And so you had a community of people building houses at that point and going into small businesses around them.
From the start, the Frostown subdivision had been a neighborhood in transition.
And the Anglos were the first purchasers of these lots. And there were no Germans in the original Frostown. However, in a matter of 5 to 7 years, more Germans began to come into the community from Europe and began to purchase property, build homes, settle there. And for an entire generation, they were the prominent signature of that area, all the way up until, like, I would say maybe the 1880s, before it began to shift away from being a solid German community.
The most prominent name of those German settlers belonged to the Settegast brothers.
And the Settegast went on to prominence in Houston to the extent where the 7.5 minute quadrangle that the U.S. Geological Service provides named the entire quadrant, the Settegast quadrant. So that was a lot of real estate.
The German population had waned by the late 1800s.
The Germans moved out, a great number of working blacks moved into the community. And there was a lot of Italian ownership also. And after about 1910, when more Mexican Americans began to come into our community, there was a great influx of Hispanics to this same neighborhood, so there was competition for space. And then by the period of 1936 to 1955, which was the Barrio de Alacran period, it was mostly a Hispanic neighborhood.
One famous feature of the neighborhood was the Settlement House, which operated next to Rusk Elementary School.
Now that was the site of the Settegast home, and the Settegast home had been turned into an educational facility for the immigrant Mexican population, in which they were teaching practical sciences such as cooking and stenography and language skills and getting these people set up to work and to adapt. And one of the people that I know personally that came out and was a product of that Settlement House is Felix Fraga. And he, of course, you know, he has this fabulous career. He was educated there, learned to speak English there, and now became the basic leader of the Settlement House, which became neighborhood centers later on.
Most recognizable today is the colorful McKee Street Bridge.
It's kind of like if you would visualize like a suspension bridge at the speed of concrete, frozen like concrete, but it would be basically the same principle. It turned out to be a really beautiful structure, and they lined it with bricks. And I can remember in the blueprints that I have, they have Model A Fords shown on the blueprints where they load the Model A's up with counterweights, with weights, and they park it on the bridge overnight to see if it holds up. Apparently it did. Our organization was able to put it on the National Historic Register a few years ago. And one of the reasons I think it went on the register was because when I painted the bridge and created sort of a media fury about the bridge when the color scheme was very popular, I think it still is popular, I knew I was contributing to something other than just having fun with paint, but I didn't know for sure what.
By the mid-1930s, Frostown had become a slum known as the Barrio Alacran, or the Scorpion.
The story is that the police did not want to go into Shrimp Alley and Fish Alley, into those heavy concentrated areas at night in that neighborhood because there was a lot of crime, a lot of poverty, a lot of row houses, and at one time there were five saloons right around Gable Street and Runnels.
Freeways spelled the end of Frostown.
In the early 1950s, the city proposed building a thoroughfare into the downtown area because automobiles were becoming the preferred means of transportation in Houston. And so in the mid-50s, the city acquired the right-of-way through the Frostown subdivision.
Well, it became wiped clean when they expanded the US 59 freeway. There were beautiful oak trees along these streets of Frostown that were wiped out. I was promised that they were going to save many things that they wiped out instantly. All I had to do was blink.
The empty land of Frostown provides a rich opportunity.
Frostown is probably the only remaining archaeological site that has 1870s era ruins available.
You take Frostown, it's had all these different layers of our culture, all these cultures blended together over a period of almost 200 years, and you've got their deposits there, and many of them are intact. So what we could learn from saving Frostown as a public park and a restricted archaeological space could be really enormous.
Arts and environmental architecture are working with other entities to develop a walk that highlights lost landmarks.
There is a Citizens Electric power plant that could be recognized. It's adjacent to and on the bayou. It was the first power plant that became a utility. Of course, it blew up in about 1882. The Crystal Ice Factory, we've talked about that. The Dixon Corwell Factory was on the banks of the bayou, and Fort Humbug was near there along those railroad tracks, a Civil War earthen fort, never used, but constructed. The Settlement House also deserves a plaque of its own because it's culturally impacted so many different groups of people. Part of the program is to take these historic buildings that are reflective of the period from other locations and put a few of them out there, place them exactly where other buildings were, and try to duplicate some of the look and feel of the original community. Just create a more positive, more beautiful, safer, more engaging space on the bayou to visualize what this community was like and what it might have meant.
Frostown represents an area populated by everyday Houstonians.
You know, we spend way too much of our energy as historians and culture buffs trying to honor just the old homes and the history of the wealthy, when there's a vast number of normal people who work really hard over a long period of time that build up our culture.